Just into CNN, more than 140 Republican and conservative leaders have just signed a statement condemning the Republican National Committee's censure of GOP Congress members Liz Cheney and Adam Kinzinger. The list includes several former members of Congress and government officials. The RNC, as you'll recall, just censured Cheney and Kinzinger for their involvement with the investigation of the January 6th insurrection. And as part of the statement, the RNC accuses the two GOP lawmakers of participating in a Democratic-led persecution of what they call ordinary citizens engaged in, quote, legitimate political discourse.
Now, the same day as the censure, the Justice Department released disturbing new graphic video of what the RNC calls this legitimate political discourse. These are people attacking police officers. They're calling for lawmakers, including then Vice President Mike Pence, to be dragged through the streets. There was a gallows erected outside of the Capitol. Legitimate political discourse here. Stephanie Grisham is a former Trump White House press secretary, communications director, and she's the author of the book, I'll Take Your Questions Now, What I Saw in the Trump White House. Michael Fanone is a former D.C. Metropolitan police officer who was attacked and injured during the Capitol riot. Stephanie, I'm going to start with you because we just got in this list of more than 140 Republicans, former officials, as Allison said, former elected officials. What does this say about your party that the RNC now says what we watched was legitimate political discourse and that these two Republican House members should be punished for trying to get to the bottom of what led to that?
I mean, it shows that right now the RNC is focused more on pleasing Trump rather than, you know, sticking to conservative principles. They're focused on punishing two of their own members for speaking their truth and standing up for the Constitution. I do believe that history will look back on the RNC and this choice and look at it poorly. And, you know, I was proud to be on that list of people who signed the letter. I do believe there's power in numbers, and I think we're starting to slowly chip away at this really big, big, ugly boulder that the RNC has become.
Michael, no one knows better than you that this wasn't legitimate political discourse, that it was violence. You were subjected to grievous injuries. And in fact, the Department of Justice just released new video from a new perspective of you actually being attacked. And Victor and I and our producers debated whether we wanted to show this because we don't want you to have to relive this hideous moment again and again. But I know that you told us it was okay to show this. And so we're showing this. And so your reaction as you hear that that's what the RNC was trying to pass off as legitimate discourse?
Well, first, I think the RNC has become the political wing of the Proud Boys, Oath Keepers, and Three Percenters. They seem to be, well, let me say this. Again, I was there on January 6th. I didn't see any political discourse. What I saw was violent insurrectionists threatening and assaulting police officers, breaking through police lines and barricades, and causing destruction and physical injury in doing so.
Yeah.
And Stephanie, as I said, that those insurrectionists, some of them shouting, "Hang Mike Pence," because the former president lied to them and said that he had the, under his purview, he could essentially overturn the election. And the January 6th committee has spoken with Mark Short, his former chief of staff. They've spoken with Greg Jacobs, one of his top aides. Mark Short was asked over the weekend about the potential for subpoenaing the former vice president. Here's what he said.
I think it's very different to subpoena a former vice president to talk about private conversations he had with the President of the United States. It's never happened before, and I think we have some significant concerns about the committee, Chuck. The committee truly is not really a bipartisan committee.
And then after that, we heard from Zoe Lofgren, who is a member of that committee. She heard that interview, and here's what she said.
I heard Mr. Short's comment that, you know, we wouldn't want to ask him about his conversations with the president. It's not clear that that would be off the table, but clearly the conversations that the vice president had with Professor Eastman and others are of interest, but we may find out everything we need to know from other sources.
So what do you think? Is this the time to, they say it's unprecedented, a lot of this is unprecedented, to subpoena the former vice president to get answers about the pressure from the former vice president and the scheme to try to overturn the election?
You know, I see where Mark is coming from. I worked with him extensively, and he's, you know, he was a very pragmatic voice of reason in the White House quite often. I do see where he's coming from. However, as you just said, this is all unprecedented. I would hope that perhaps Vice President Pence would go and just speak to them voluntarily. And I believe that the January 6th committee would keep it targeted to that day and, you know, some of the orders he was given or things that were asked of him. I don't think they have to get into some of the more private conversations between a president and a vice president, which I do believe can be very sacred. I hope that Mike Pence will speak to them. I think that he, of all people, has so much insight and so much to say. So I'm just going to keep my fingers crossed that ends up happening.
Michael, speaking of former Vice President Pence, as you know, the violence that day, what precipitated it was that violent mob thought erroneously and had been told that Mike Pence could, you know, overrule the voters of the United States. And this past weekend, on Friday, we heard for the first time former Vice President Mike Pence say that Donald Trump was wrong, and I just want to play it for anyone who missed it.
President Trump is wrong. I had no right to overturn the election. Frankly, there is no idea more un-American than the notion that any one person could choose the American president.
Michael, was that a significant moment to your ears?
No. I give Mike Pence zero credit in making that statement over a year out from the January 6th insurrection. And to be completely honest with you, if he was a person of integrity or courage or any character whatsoever, he would be voluntarily testifying before the January 6th committee, not sending his subordinates to do it, his dirty work for him. I think he wants to save some type of political face. Maybe he thinks that in the future he could possibly run for president. But I think his actions are disgraceful, and I give him no credit whatsoever.
Michael Fanone, Stephanie Grisham, great to see both of you. Thank you both.
Thank you.